did they have such loud makeup back in the day when you saw the films that you saw that the eyebrows were, you know, fierce, the acting was very loud. All this was because of theater. Because guys in the back would have to see me. And in theater, there is nothing called a close-up. So when you're watching somebody from there, I had to be appealing, my dance moves, my choreography, my expression on the face had to be loud, had to be, you know, exaggerated. So all makeup darkness go loud to another. So that hangover was still carried when cinema came. And the initial cinema was like the camera in the center over here, just capturing the entire thing on film. So slowly people started realizing that you can actually go to the character, come close to the character. So closure started happening. So then suddenly this loud makeup and the loud expression and loud delivery of dialogues and exaggerated, all that started slowly diminishing. So there was a hangover of that. There was a hangover of that in cinema. You can see it in old Hollywood films, you can see it in old in Indian films. And in some regions, I think it's still there. Somehow they prefer it. But this whole thing about, you know, exaggerating your moves was not necessary anymore visually. People started acting more casually, and you can't get more casual than this. It seems like you're sitting in a chair in that room and seeing, experiencing the whole thing. You're enjoying this whole process. So similarly, in sound also, you did not need to shake that guy out of the scene with a loud dialogue in May. So that's sort of the thing, that's sort of the loud acting 70s, 80s ka chala gaya. When there was an impact, you had to create an impact. So there was this wala chakkar that came from the music department. So that was a way to create an extra drama. Today it sounds very basic. Today it sounds very juvenile. So music, for me, is the easy way out. Now what happened is, you know, the way you're designing the music, the way he's composing the music also depends on the kind of design that you do. So my interaction is always with the composer or the music director. You have to keep tracks, brother, just now. So when we have this kind of a discussion, he tells me, yeah, what kind of a design are you thinking of over here? So when it's a war and it's a clutter with swords and hooves and all that happening with bullets and machine gun in your face, all that sort of a thing happening, you cannot get so busy with the music. Otherwise, you get a full, complete khichdi. Like, you will neither be able to hear the music, you will not be able to hear the sound like a bird. It's going to be a major khichdi that is going to happen. So what happens is that we try and be a little bit mutual. Okay, you don't use a chitchak kind of a thing when they are actually fighting or running, when there is a war happening, when there are machine guns and all that happening. Create that space. And what is also important is, where should the music come in? If you remember the movie scene, the whole action happens, that sudden surprise bullet comes in and takes it, and all of us kind of get psyched by it. But you realize that, dude, something is not right. When he sees those nails on the road, and he realizes that's the ambush. That's where the music is coming. Because the moment you put music in your conditioning me, you are making me apprehend. Now suppose this sort of a thing, I played it with that sort of a music right from the start. Then it would not be so much of a suspense game. How come you would not, you would happen with the character and you would think, kuch hone wala hai. Because the music conditions you that way. So when you are making a film, for especially for directors, you have to understand that, you know, it's, even if it's the music, you know, it could be a very good composition. But if it's put in the wrong place, it may not have that sort of an impact. If you shift the tone instead of the starting of the screen, if you have shifted it to where you can see the nails, there is a lot more movement to it. This is how we say, we ideate, we design. I gave my design to the music composer because that also is a sound designer I am responsible for. I have to bring out the best in the songs, I have to bring out the best in the music. I have to bring out the best in the dialogues. Unless it's an action scene where there's so much of action, there's so much of this thing that you cannot actually have same sound. Then you have to adopt that. But here again, for those of you who are having, especially dubbing engineers, you have to realize that when you are dubbing a scene, you are dubbing it inside the studio. The actor does not know what is happening over there. So there is a lot of loud noise happening, there is a lot of people shouting and stuff, or you're in a club or you're in a party. They are screaming at each other because you're trying to hear him and he's trying to hear you and you're trying to hear yourself. So in a studio environment, when you're recording two simple people standing in a radio station, so you have to make sure that the actor, usually most of the actors do understand how to do that, but you still have to make them understand in the dubbing theater, boss, this is a noisy environment for Uncha Bold. Uncha Bold is another lot volume. I'm talking about pitch. So instead of saying, hi, how are you? Where are you? Hi, what's happening? How are things? Tu kahan jana tha? So now in the radio station, I'm talking to you, hi, tu kahan tha? Kahan tha? See, my volume has not increased, but my soul has increased. Because I'm trying to stand above the noise of the engine, the stuff that we heard in the radio station. So my dialogue delivery itself is going to be, has to be taken like that. That means solve 90% of the problem. Then of course you have your pitch corrections, you have your equalizers, you have all these other things. You may have heard these hawkers. That's what they do. They filter out their voice. So when you're standing in a station, when you're or your train is passing by and stuff like that, then one guy goes jai jai. So you pay your rent, kitna hai? Together 10 rupiah. He doesn't say 10 rupiah. Why? Because he's saving his voice. We don't know if he's equalized his voice, he's filtered, put a filter in his voice. So what has happened is that particular frequency has cut through the entire building of lower mid frequency and it has reached your ear and you can see. Because high frequency is directional. It's a short waveform. So if somebody whistles at you, you can immediately turn around and say, okay, yeah, so it's glad. But if there is a huge explosion, then we are going to be like, where did this happen? Where did this blow? Because if you are doing 100 hertz, it's going to vibrate in about 12 feet. So you will not know where is it coming from. So we say high frequency is directional. So we have to understand. Jo aap sun rahe ho, wo main frequency bol raha hu. So you have to understand how to create and how to design your track in such a way that they don't interfere with each other. So this hawker has cut through that to sell his chai or his cinema or whatever. And he is saved his voice. At the end of the day, he can go and have a proper conversation with his wife. So that is how he has learned by nature to adapt to a situation or his environment. So if you look back, that is the reason. Any questions? Any interaction? Yes, sir.
Sir, does sound happen first and then the music happens, or does music happen first and then? Either way, why so?
See, what happens is, we still call it background music. We still call it background music. It's not really background music because there's some music playing in the background. We have this thing of filling up an empty space. So push up is bajna chahiye wahan pe. Today is not necessary because you can hear every little detail of sound, so there's no need to fill up the whole thing. Because absolute silence is also, like I told you earlier, disturbing. So music on its own happens. So the composition probably either it's a theme taken from the songs which are in the film, or they have sent the music for, so he's probably still composing it. So it could have a really no rules. He could probably look at it and he'll say, I'll compose it in whatever time, I'll create this particular theme. But I'm not waiting for the music, he's not waiting for my design. I'm anyways going ahead with my stuff. I'm anyways going ahead with Foley, I'm anyways going ahead with nonsense sound. He's anyways going ahead with music. But where we do exchange nonsense, boss, if this sort of a scene is there, who does it get there? And he comes to my studio and says, can you tell me a sound design? So I